You could have heard this episode 48 hours early in our Patreon, patreon.com/indieheadspodcast. By joining us for as low as $1 a month, you'll receive episodes early and gain access to our Discord server. All of our upcoming episodes will be up on our Patreon 48 hours before it hits our public podcast feeds. But if you're hearing this via our Patreon feed, we thank you so much for your support. We especially want to thank our Real Ones patrons, including Beck Etienne, Georgia Mikowski, Rihanna Cruz, Alan S., Josiah Duncan, Jenna LaFleur, Matt Cameron, Delaney Miller, Grant in the Back of My Dragula, Pablo Escobar's Hippos, Jackson Christ, Alec Felder, Sandy Nemo, Jeremy Bowl, Alex Gershmanoff, I Like Books, Jonathan David, Sarah Moore, Max Kapuzinski, Mark Berry, Aaron Hulsamer, Darian Fisher, GayOrs420, Cal50, Chubby Checker X Big Bopper Erotic Fanfiction, Chris Wade, Jacqueline Cottiga, Kevin John, Jake Wald, Eraserhead Baby, Rob Marino, Max, Dylan, Waffle113, Gavin490Freak, and Maze Farms. To become a Real One, consider supporting us for $5 a month on Patreon, where we'll receive a bonus episode every month and get a shout out at the top of the pod. Anyways, though, enjoy the episode. Hello, everybody, and welcome to an episode of the Indieheads podcast. Before we begin, I just want to make an announcement, and that we have a new cast member, Grant. I'm proud to announce that you are now a new cast member of the Indieheads podcast. Do you accept?
Graciously, I'd like to thank the Academy for choosing me.
Right. But seriously, I Grant, we are extending an offer to you to be a member of the Indieheads podcast. You have contributed so much over the last year and a half since we sort of had our kind of rebrand since the Black Number Ones, and I feel like it's a no brainer to bring you on as a cast member. And but on top of this, for the episode today, Grant, do you want to reveal your costume of sorts, your cosplay to Gavin? You've already shown me. You've already shown Natalie. Gavin, take a look at the camera. See what Grant's rocking with.
It's an honor for my first thing as an official member of the Indieheads podcast, being a visual bit on a podcast. But all right,
we'll post a picture. Yeah. We'll post a picture.
I am starting my video now. Hi, Gavin.
Oh my God, that's this is. I actually don't like this because of like that's just Rob Zombie in front of me. Right? Rob. This is. I'm actually scared by how accurate this is.
Yeah, I was scared too. When Grant popped it, I was afraid.
I only saw the picture that Grant sent me like hours or not like an hour ago. So like seeing it in motion is just disconcerting.
Oh, I've been in this for like, let's see, it's 7 o'clock, about 2.5 hours now.
Oh my God. And your skin is like burning, right?
Yes, I used non-skin friendly glue for my beard.
Oh no.
It's okay.
You might need to
it's worth it.
We might need to get rid of Rob.
Well, let's just get into it.
Love this one.
Hello everybody and welcome back to an episode of the Indieheads podcast. I'm your host Maddie, aka Marvin Prince on Twitter. On this episode I am joined by Natalie, Gavin, and Grant. Grant, who is currently dressed up like Rob Zombie right now. The most scarily accurate cosplay I've ever seen Grant do. And Grant has said a lot of crazy
Dave
shit
Navarro
on this
who?
Podcast.
Yeah, this is scary.
Navarro was good, but this is like an extra like effort. Because like you've got the eyes and the beard and the it's freaky. It's freaky, but it's appropriate freaky because we are talking about the music of Rob Zombie as Grant has put together another Dave Grohl playlist for us. Highlighting the many career highlights of one Rob Zombie. Grant, what's your history with the Robster?
Well, I want to give some lore real quick. This episode was originally not going to be a Rob episode. Me and Nat were collaborating on a playlist because I found a very post-Twilight Scholastic Book Fair kind of book on how to be a vampire that gave music recommendations. And we're going to take the bands from that and just make a playlist on how to be a vampire in real life. But then a movie trailer dropped for one, Rob Zombie's The Munsters, and everything was fucking out the door at that point. We have to talk about this man. I did not like Rob Zombie in high school. I thought he tried too hard, and all my fellow horror nerds all talked about what a butchering he did of Halloween. But I am a late bloomer and I'm ready to call myself a Rob Zombie stan because everything I've learned about this man this week has just utterly fascinated me, including and not including the songs on this playlist.
I would like to state for the record, not that anyone asked, but I have, like, pretty much, aside from Dragula and, what is it, Black Sunshine, the two songs we've already talked about, I have no admiration for Rob Zombie's music, and I've never seen any of his movies. This is just a political move, so Maddie can't complain about a bonus episode. I'm happy to do this because I love a type of guy, and Rob Zombie's a type of guy, and his brain is full of ideas that we will analyze more than anyone's supposed to, I guess.
Yeah.
But this was fun. This is a fun playlist.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just want to state really quick. The Porto episode, we've been hyping it up for a while. It is coming out on July 4th. Happy Independence Day, America. Hopefully our listeners who support us at the $5 a month tier enjoy listening to us talk about some porno music. This is the last time we are mentioning this.
let's clarify this. It's not porno music. It's not music made by porn stars. Play in a porno. Music made by adult film actors and actresses. I'm going to say this. It's going to be about as sexual as this episode is.
That's true.
I think we're looking at an even split.
Yeah, Rob is a very sexual man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll get into it.
I mean, not only one of our finest type of guys, one of our finest type of wife guys.
He's, oh, yes, yes, yes,
the most
absolutely.
Ultimate wife guy of them all.
Yeah. If I can, because my just the way I live my life is, I think you got to find somebody who loves you like Rob Zombie loves Sherry Moon Zombie's ass and showing her ass in his movies.
True.
But like, I do want to, mostly because we've been mentioning this in chat, it's mostly going to be me and Grant driving this, and mostly Grant at that, but like, I do want to get like my own background with Rob Zombie out of the way, mostly because I feel like in some ways it makes sense to do this, because we've been like steadily dripping the podcast with Rob Zombie like in jokes for a while between both Dragula and Black Sunshine. And so it feels kind of like this is the culmination of those bits. But it's also kind of like a weird sort of culmination for me, where it was for years I had like heard maybe a few of the White Zombie songs that were like appearing in the Guitar Hero games. I don't think I heard Dragula until like maybe a couple of years ago, actually, which is kind of weird. And
the Matrix.
And his movies were like this weird thing where it was like this always kind of like growing up, it was just one of those things where keeping it at arm's distance, I was always like hyping them up in my head as these like very fucked up like movies that were going to like ruin your life if you watch them. And then it was like, I watched House of a Thousand Corpses a few years ago, and I'm like, this is just like a fun time. It's a fun time with some wacky guys.
Absolutely true.
And I feel like Rob Zombie is just the kind of guy who's just going to give you a fun time with wacky guys. And like, I feel like this playlist is great because it's giving you a bunch of different angles into the type of guy that Rob is. Like, he's a man of multitudes, as we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's just get into it. So, Grant, what is the first song on today's playlist?
Well, we've talked about Dragula, which is the song from Hellbilly Deluxe. Let's talk about the other song everyone really loves from it, Living Dead Girl.
Oh boy.
So I had not heard this one before, and the first thing that struck me is that the chorus has the exact same like meter and stresses as Dragula. It is like...
Basically, yes.
And I was not being super familiar with his music before entering the playlist, I was just like, oh no, is this like the only Mo that the guy works in? But like, thankfully this is the only other time, at least in the playlist, he does this. And honestly, it slams. Like, I've managed to get through another like half play of the playlist and like come back to this one at the top. This is a good like intro into like what Rob Zombie's whole deal is.
This was the first Rob Zombie song I ever heard. This is what plays over the intro credits of the classic film Bride of Chucky.
I was gonna ask which Chucky movie this is in, because that's where I know it from, too.
Yeah. It plays as Jennifer Tilly goes up to the police station to get Chucky's remains back.
Yeah, this one's good.
It's fun. This is, again, in my general thoughts on this post, that this is just a fun playlist from a fun guy. It makes fun music that's really spooky and scary.
Yeah.
But, again, I'm here on this episode. Not really. I have nothing to say. This episode, folks, I got a beer. I got a Bud Light right here. I'm going to crack it open right now.
That's right. I mean, this is a can be said about probably every single song.
Get this ASMR real quick.
Okay. Crack that beer. Here we go. That one's for you at home. This can be said about all the other songs, but it sounds like it's like a song for a stripper who thinks like evil clowns should be tattooed on their body. like that's kind of what, like, I guess Rob Zombie's entire lane is. But like, I mean, those people need music too, and those people should have good music.
Yeah.
So I salute you, Rob.
This could easily play in the strip club scene in Glenn Danzig's Veronica.
Yeah.
I would like to, one, mention that the living dead girl in this music video is in fact Sherry Moon Zombie. And I would like to talk a little bit about the samples at the very beginning of this. It starts with a ch-ch-ch-ch noise. It's like hi-hats and a voice saying, "Who is this irresistible creature who has an insatiable love for the dead?" I was wondering where those were from because they were both really familiar to me. And there is a straight-to-video, I don't even want to call it a movie. It's just a compilation of trailers. Called Mad Ron's Previews from Hell. It's like half Grindhouse trailers and half bad comedy with a zombie ventriloquist dummy. But in it, they play the trailers for Wes Craven's controversial film, The Last House on the Left, which is where that hi-hat sound is from. And the vocal lines are from a movie called Lady Frankenstein, and they're both in this videotape, and I don't think it's a coincidence. I think Rob had to have seen this at some point.
I mean, are we going to talk about his cribs? I'm assuming
we
have
to talk about his cribs.
Yeah, just let me know when. Let me know when I'll find it.
But yeah, I believe that after seeing his house.
Yeah, I feel like Rob Zombie is the kind of guy who just has a bunch of horror ephemera and detritus just like sitting around. He's the guy who like
pull the cribs up. Pull the cribs
okay,
up.
Yeah.
All right, we're going for the cribs.
Yeah, let's just get right in the cribs. I want to say, yeah, Rob. I have to imagine Rob Zombie's crib is much like the crib that I hooked up with a girl at.
The Funko Pop house.
Yes, the Funko Pop house. If anyone doesn't remember the story, I'll keep it brief because I probably told it on the podcast before. But I hooked up with a girl on Tinder. She was house sitting for like two of her friends, and in the house was like a wall of Funko Pops, an entire like room just full of like horror memorabilia, just spread out all over the place. Like after we hooked up, like I was like laying down in bed, flat on my back. I like stand up like the Undertaker, and I immediately am staring at Boomerang from the Suicide Squad.
Hell,
fucking giant corny Australian ass motherfucker just staring daggers at me. And then, that's a fun experience in my life that I love to talk about. But
I feel like it's a blessing. Oh. I feel like it's a blessing. I've been on multiple episodes. You've told this story.
Yes, it's.
Yeah.
I mean, hey, it's. I tell. It's a funny. It's a fun story.
It's a fun
story. I like telling it. Here we go. All right.
Pirate bar.
Hello. I'm Danzig Rob Zombie, and this is my house. So. Come on inside, and I'll show you some.
I think Rob Zombie is like one of like two white dudes I know that can like kind of pull off dreads. It's him and like Garrett Hunter from Mega 64, and that's it.
He listed two shows.
Monsters, Adam's
Family.
The main thing in the front entryway is our jackalope. I hit that driving in Wisconsin a couple years back.
I love how he just is just a guy. Like,
yeah,
truly there's nothing special about him other than he just loves
this
stuff.
Lame dad jokes.
Here's the living room, which I don't know why it's a living room because there's a lot of dead stuff in here.
God,
from the Addams Family, the original Addams Family, not the movies or anything else. The real one.
The real polar bear. Addams Family.
Herman Munster on the chimney.
It's like he's living in the horror version of the Garfield house where I think you should leave.
He has a Holy Trinity painting of himself, Herman Munster, and Boris Karloff as Frankenstein.
I was in kindergarten. I went to Tijuana, and this thing was in front of a sombrero store. And then about 30 years later, I saw it again and I bought it.
It's a big creature from the Black Lagoon.
Oh my god. Bed.
He just has a bed in his living
water
room?
It's like a giant this is living room, yes.
It's very comfortable. Why wouldn't I sleep in this? It's incredibly comfortable. Here's my electric chair. It doesn't work anymore. I broke it.
Here's my electric chair.
He broke it.
So
a mummy crocodile.
Pirate bar.
So we made it a pirate bar.
Call John Taffer. He has a photo of the
pirate's tavern.
Look in our skulls and our Jolly Rogers and all the things make it for a good pirate. This house was owned originally.
There's a mermaid with tits out that they can show.
I'm Bonanza. And now it's owned by me.
Action figure of himself at the bar.
I'd like to point out in the I have the video for one of the songs pulled up, and on the side it gave me a recommended Father John Misty video, and I'm pretty sure it's because the two of them are just like 2 degrees of like physical resemblance apart.
Yeah.
Munster go home. I got a lot of Munster stuff.
Yeah, Father John Misty is like, what if Rob Zombie wasn't like a cool ass guy? You know.
He has so much monster stuff. Like
he fucking loves the monsters,
man. That's
why
he's the best person to make that movie.
I can't believe we're going to talk about the monsters more on a different episode.
Oh, I just remember. Oh.
There's a lot of secret. But I'm not going to show you because then it wouldn't be secret.
I want to see it. Well, invite me to your house, Rob.
You got to see the contents of this guy's fridge.
Oh, God. Okay. Hang on, I'm just gonna pause. Is it gonna be as good as the Maroon 5 Cribs video where the entire fridge is just Red Bulls? It's just Red Bulls.
No, but there's something that should not be surprising.
Okay, let's continue.
Our fake stained glass window is just a regular window and I spray painted it and it looks like stained glass. You'd never know.
That actually looks pretty good.
It does look pretty good.
Our fridge is pretty sad because we're leaving for tour, yeah. So we only have things in there that won't rot over the next 2 months. But we do have our jack-o'-lantern jelly
bowl. look at the jack-o'-lantern jello!
It's a severed jack-o'-lantern jello head.
That's the only food he has in his fridge.
I was going to say, my guess was going to be a severed head, and that's pretty close.
Because I don't know what else to do with them.
Damn, he like sold a lot of fucking records.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. So I feel like I know Rob more as like a movie director than like a musician. So it's like always crazy. Like, oh yeah, like dude was like balling throughout the 90s and early 2000s.
He was huge. If you try to watch a movie in his TV room, he will kill you.
But it was like the thing is like he was successful enough with like his shit for the longest time that he could afford to like spend years getting a movie made.
Mm-hmm.
Oh God. Oh God.
His house looks like the House of a Thousand Corpses.
House of a Thousand VHS tapes, more like it.
Damn, he's just like me for real.
I thought this pretty much sums up everything. That room is just like what my place is currently like. It's just we're no different, he and I.
Yeah, man, fuck the Criterion Closet. I want to step inside Rob Zombie's movie closet.
Yes.
Yeah.
Look at this room.
Oh my god, this bedroom. Holy shit.
Sims 3 ass house.
It kind of feels just like, you know, a guest bedroom at the Haunted Mansion. Here's a good painting. Me and my girlfriend from the Living Dead Girl video.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, before he was married.
No slow motion, like, shrug, like, yeah, me and my extremely hot girlfriend.
Isn't a
girlfriend
thunderstorm
future wife, of course.
Isn't the thunderstorm on the ceiling the thing the Rainforest Cafe does?
Oh my god, what the fuck is this
ceiling?
Look at
the Disney room!
Awesome.
I had this brilliant idea before we moved in to paint the entire room like a mural from Nightmare Before Christmas. I put about a half an hour's worth of work into it before I decided that was really not a project worth pursuing.
Just one shitty corner.
Here's the pool, and as you can see, it's the most neglected part of the house because I don't really like to swim. I don't like water. I don't like being out in the sun.
Of course, Rob Zombie doesn't like to be out in the sun.
Broken when we moved in, still broken.
I'll say that's a tiny ass jacuzzi. That's an AJ Moser hose level jacuzzi.
Yeah,
if it's like one person.
Oh, here we go. So this house, again, this is an incredible house. I'd love to live in this house.
I want to go over to his house and watch movies.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Goodbye. All right.
Thank you, Rob.
Oh, my God.
I think that's pretty crucial to understanding his brain.
Yeah, I do want to mention some stuff about his youth. He fell in love with horror movies because he had a babysitter that would just drop him off at the movies and then leave to smoke weed with her boyfriend. And that's where he fell in love with horror movies. And now, Maddie, if you could just read the first paragraph of the early life on his Wikipedia page for us.
Oh, God. Okay, let's read this. Okay. Robert Bartley Cummings was born in Haverhill, Massachusetts, United States, on January 12, 1965. He is the oldest son of Robert and Louise Cummings. His younger brother, Michael David Cummings, known professionally as Spider One, is the lead singer of the band Power Man 5000. What the fuck?
Yep.
Hell yeah.
I didn't fucking know that.
They have a super group now.
We're Tony Hawk Pro Skater 1.
That fucking rocks. Anyways, growing up, Cummings had a fascination with horror films, and has stated that he always wanted to be Alice Cooper, Steven Spielberg, Bela Lugosi, and Stan Lee. His parents worked at a carnival, but they chose to leave after a riot broke out and tents were set on fire. Cummings recalled the experience in an interview saying, "Everybody's pulling out guns. You can hear guns going off. I remember this one guy we knew. He was telling us where to go, and some guy just ran up to him and hit him in the face with a hammer. Just busted his face wide open. My parents packed up real quick, and we took off."
Keep going.
Cummings graduated Haverhill High School in 1983. He moved to New York City and began attending Pratt Institute, where he met eventual bandmate Sean Yasult. Before the success of White Zombie, he was a production assistant for the television series Pee-wee's Playhouse.
There we go.
Everything about him makes sense to me.
Oh my fucking God.
Now imagine a Pee-wee's Playhouse reboot, but with his MTV Cribs house.
Oh, I would be so happy.
Oh my God. What if Pee-wee Herman were fucked up? All right. What if we were fucked up? Oh my God. This is...
Do you understand the mindset a little before now?
I do understand the mindset a lot.
The thing that I'm trying to break apart is the like carnival riot story. Like, I'm trying to be like, is he the guy who's so sincere that this is completely true? Or is he, based on his like dad jokes in the Cribs thing, is he doing like a Robert Pattinson level troll where he's just telling this like brutal carnival story, being like, this is what you expect from me?
He has shown pictures, I believe, of him and his brother as kids. Like, as carnies, but I'm not sure if I believe the riot.
hard to say.
We need to find police reports.
If it's true, it makes so much sense.
It does.
About every movie he's ever made.
Yes, it makes everything line up so much more. Like, why the Firefly family, like, why they're all, like, or at least, like, one of them's, like, a clown initially. Like, everything makes sense. Oh my God. Okay, let's move on to the next song. Next song. Again, this is right. Next song. Our next song is let's make sure I get the name of this right, because it's not showing the full name. Oh my God, this is a long record. Okay, this is like a compilation.
Yeah.
Ratfinks, Suicide Tanks, and Cannibal Girls from White Zombie. So I'm gonna play that real quick. This one's kind of sick. I really dug this one. At least some of the electronic work.
You may recognize this song, too, from a certain movie. A certain two dudes that rock and just made a comeback having hallucinations in the desert.
Right, okay. Yeah, that's where I know this song.
Bill and Ted?
Nope. Think cartoon, baby.
Oh, Beavis and Butthead.
That's right.
Rob
Zombie directed that entire segment in Beavis and Butthead Do America. All the animation and stuff was from his sick and twisted mind, and they play this song over it.
Yeah, it's really good. It's a good scene.
Glad you brought that up, because I feel like, again, once we get into the movie stuff, I feel like understanding that he got his start doing animation stuff for Beavis and Butthead is really important to understanding his sense of humor and outlook on the world.
Absolutely.
Wow, shit.
Like, he is kind of like if you put Beavis, Butthead, and Pee-wee Herman all together and just made him watch Bela Lugosi movies.
Yeah. Yeah, kind of.
Would you just, again,
this song's good.
I think from that Cribs episode, and it's just like, I feel like the instinct would be to call him a dumb guy, but he's not dumb. He's definitely not a dumb guy. He's a very smart guy.
He likes dumb things, but nothing's wrong.
He's
with
very
that.
Sincere about liking dumb things, but like every single interview I've seen him give, he's like very like thoughtful about just like the whole process that goes into his shit. Like he makes dumb shit, but with like a lot of thought put into it.
Yeah, I was reading an article that, well, I guess I should mention at this point that I've been living like Rob Zombie for the past month. I haven't watched basically anything unless it's a Rob Zombie film or a 70s grindhouse drive-in film that inspired Rob Zombie. I watched a lot of I Drink Your Blood, I Eat Your Skin, Three on a Meat Hook, Deranged, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, stuff like that. And also, I found an article where Rob talked about his veganism. He gets so mad at the dairy industry. And he talks about how he's like, yeah, I would never eat at a place that exploits animals and people like McDonald's and Burger King. But it's really cool that they're making veggie burgers now. All I could think was, good for you, Rob. And so I had a veggie burger today. I had my coffee, didn't have any cream. I drank the Rob Zombie coffee again today, and it's better black than it is with the cream and sugar. And now I feel like I know why.
Damn, alrighty then.
Damn. I have nothing to say about any of that, but like on this song, because I feel like part of what my journey was listening to this playlist was just in real time discovering the different modes of Rob Zombie, and it was so cool to have this right after like Living Dead Girl, which is like my basically like initial perception of Rob Zombie's music output, where this is this kind of like Gavin's mentioning that it was kind of like an electro-industrial like blend. But like as the playlist was going on, I was just like picking apart like different pieces of things that I was like seeing in his music, because it sounds like dumb guy music from the outside, but I could like see elements of like kind of early 90s like industrial. I could see shit like Grant and I were talking that like his voice on certain tracks sounds both like Gibby Haynes of Butthole Surfers, but also like Tom Waits specifically in the intro of Primus's Tommy the Cat, where it's just like this distortion heavy thing that he's just making into this kind of like squawking noise. So it's, I don't know, it's I think this is a like cool little like flip side of like showing what a Rob Zombie song can be.
Absolutely. He pulls from so many different genres, especially White Zombie were really funk centric. You could tell a lot of Shawnee Salt's bass riffs are all very slap bass. They're all great. Of course, we talked about Black Sunshine during the Scary Cars, and that's one of the greatest bass riffs of all time. But he really expands into a lot of different genres as it goes on. On Hellbilly Deluxe, a lot of people think it's his best album, but it's definitely, it's Dragula and Dragula Lights, which is why people like it. But I feel like I like it when he branches out into more... not his initial wheelhouse. I guess you couldn't make that argument with this. This was before Dragula in any of those songs, but it was still a collective of everyone who was in White Zombie all pulling their influences. But I really love this song. I think this is just nasty riff on nasty riff. Nothing that Rob is saying in this song, it doesn't need to make sense. We were talking about this. This is just funky grooves and nonsense. This is like the good non-evil version of the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Yeah. Rob Zombie is chaotic good Anthony Kiedis,
basically. Yes.
Yeah,
which we will get into later, because I feel like his vocalizations in some of these songs get into like Kiedis nonsense, and like some of the lyricism on here is just like pure Kiedis.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he loves him some words that just do not make sense next to each other.
God. Well, then, we are on to our...
Before we get to that, I want to say, Ratfinks, Suicide Tanks, and Cannibal Girls. You know what that sounds like to me, Maddie?
What's that sound like?
That sounds like Three from Hell to me. Let's talk about Three from Hell, the most recent film by Rob Zombie. Nat, have you seen Three from Hell?
No. I have not. So I'll say up front, the only film of his that I have seen, I believe, is House of a Thousand Corpses. So I'm going to let you lead most of the movie discussion, because most of what I know is going to be from that and like assorted shit that I know from, like, say, the Halloweens.
All right. So Three from Hell came out in 2019. It is the final in the Firefly trilogy, of course, being House of a Thousand Corpses, Devil Rejects, and Three from Hell. Unfortunately, this is the weakest of the group, I would say. House of a Thousand Corpses, we'll get into it. Devil's Corpses, we'll get into it. But they feel like two very distinct movies. This one feels like Devil's Rejects, but weaker. A lot of it does have to do with the fact that Sid Haig, the great Sid Haig, who played Captain Spaulding in the previous two entries, was, for lack of better terms, dying during the production of this film. He was originally going to be in a lead role in this film, but he showed up to set and Rob just saw what not great health he was in. He clearly looks different. And so Captain Spaulding had to be cut out of the movie super early on. I think he only gets like one real dialogue scene. So they had to create a new character to be the third from hell. It's Richard Blake, who does a lot of Rob Zombie's films. He's okay. This one turns them from like a real grasp on like a psychotic family, and now they're fighting a cartel of luchadors in Mexico. It's Rob doing what he loved. Every single movie, this is the thesis I've come up with. He wears his heart on his sleeve in a really fucked up and twisted way with all his films. Like, the things he loved always show up. Like carnivals and clowns. And they're watching the Munsters in basically every movie he's in. He'll always cast these like vintage horror icons like Ken Foray from Dawn of the Dead and Dee Wallace and Patricia Quinn. The cast are always people that you know from horror films. And obviously his wife, he films her with so much love in these goddamn movies. But unfortunately, this one just did not do it for me. It felt like Devil's Rejects 2 when the other two were completely separate films. Maddie, I will make all of these movie talks a whole lot shorter. I'm holding the Indieheads podcast hostage now. Conspiring, baby. I will do two sentences or less on every movie from here on out if you let me and Gavin do a scary Halloween stream this year for charity.
I mean, that's fine. I mean, I'm down with it.
We will raise
it.
Money for an abortion fund.
I literally, again, like, I'm more than happy to be, again, you act like I don't like horror movies. I like
horror
movies.
Oh, it's not just horror movies. Me and Gavin found some
don't
great
make that
shit.
I'm down. Yeah, again, look, Grant, my standards are at the fucking floor right now after what I've had to deal with for the past month with Gavin and Max, all right? So, like,
you're
anything
literally
that's
making,
not that is above.
You heard Go Outside by Cults and your life was ruined for good.
It's like, all right, that was an indie shit. Let's get back to the business.
Okay, there's not that much worse. Yeah. Okay.
All right. Stay tuned. A very scary charity Hallow stream coming soon, hopefully. I'll send Nat and Maddie the link to what I've got so far. And they can
do
it. Yes.
Would love to offer early feedback on
the shit. I was going to do the Firefly trilogy in order with songs that pertain to them in this list, but I just got out of the way. It's the weakest. I'd still recommend it, but whatever. Let's talk about our next song. I already forgot what it was.
House of a Thousand Corpses.
Let's go, baby.
Yes.
I would say, you might have spoke too soon on Three from Hell, because, like, hey, we have a song from his first movie, House of a Thousand Corpses.
Okay. This shit slams. Like, the thing is, the only ones of these songs I'd heard from are the ones that are, like, explicitly movie songs before. Yes. This one being, like, the big one because of where it gets dropped at the end of House of a Thousand Corpses. But, like, God, this slams. The kind of, like, slow shamble of it is so, so, so fucking cool. And it's, like, it's cool to see him be in a mode that's, like, a little more, like, menacing than just, like, outright aggression the entire way through.
Absolutely. I love weird, quiet, partial whisper Rob up moaning. We should take shots every time a moan appears in this episode.
All right. I got my Bud Light.
We're getting more moans here than probably in the porn songs episode.
Yeah. No, well, okay. There's one. Well, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Yeah. But there's two. I'll say there's two songs in this one off the top of my head, and there's two songs in the other one.
Uh-oh.
So I think, like I said, I think we're batting 50-50
it's neck
for
and neck.
Horniness in this episode and that one. So
I just realized
I feel nothing. Yeah, feel nothing for this.
My hair is covering my Rob Zombie shirt.
Ah, perfect. But,
throw that shit back. I love this song. I love when Rob does a little bit of a country in his songs. Like, basically, the Deep South is its own character in House of a Thousand Corpses and The Devil's Reject, so him doing country is always, always welcome in my book. He loves him some hellbillies.
Oh, yes. In fact, he likes to make it a whole deluxe package.
That's right. Sometimes he does it twice.
So if we want, I can, because this is the one that I definitely feel the most lore heavy about, because I feel like, obviously, this one's very crucial, because it being his first movie and kind of the thing that allowed him to kind of make the career pivot that it did. Maddie, can I ask, how familiar are you with the, like, troubled production of House of a Thousand Corpses?
I watched the Dead Meat Kill Count on it, right, where they probably talked about it, but it's been a while since I've seen that video, so yeah. I don't remember too much.
I'm not gonna read the full thing, but, like, basically the cliff notes is, the entire thing came about because, Zombie was commissioned to do, like, a haunted house maze thing for Universal, and they were like, make a movie for us, and he was like, okay, and basically the entire way through was like, so, just so you know, I'm not, like, trying to make something that's, like, a typical, like, commercial horror movie. I'm trying to make something that's kind of fucked up and twisted. And they're like, yeah, whatever. And then they see the film and they're like, we are not releasing this. And, like, kick him to the curb. Then he goes to MGM. MGM is like, yeah, we'll do it. And then they kick him to the curb because he makes a statement that is, quote, claiming that the company had no morals for releasing the film. but where it ended up is, I think, especially important for us and our own podcast lore, because where it ended up is a studio called Lionsgate. And this was actually the first attempt that they were making in trying to venture into horror films. So because of House of a Thousand Corpses, we have Rob Zombie to thank for the Saw franchise.
That's right. Thank you, Rob.
Thank you, Rob.
Holy shit.
Yeah. I adore House of a Thousand Corpses. It's my favorite in the Firefly trilogy. Like, it.
Wow.
I say this, like, in the most positive way possible. This does feel like a movie that came out of the genesis of needing a haunted house. Everything in it is, it's clearly, like, tonally inspired by 70s grindhouse films. Clearly, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre had a massive influence on it, but it isn't like the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. It's its own deal. But he has everything he loves in it. The carnival, the clowns, the fucked up house with the fucked up Texas Chainsaw family. Fish Boy. Dr. Satan. Baby Billy from the Righteous Gemstones.
Yes.
one of the guys from The Office, and the guy that hosted Talking Dead, who we don't talk about. Yeah, the scariest guy of all.
Yeah, scarier than any killer. The Nerdist himself.
Yes. Man, it's kind of wild that, like, right off the jump, he has, like, all these kind of horror icons, because, like, he has Sid Haig, he has Bill Moseley, who got, like, his, like, first big role in, like, Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2.
Yeah,
Karen
Chop
Black
Top,
for some reason.
Oh yeah, Karen Black's the mom.
Yeah. But yeah, no, it's just very, like, this is, again, like, kind of where his influence was, like, right off the bat, where he was able to, just because of the success that he had and, like, working with a bigger studio, he was able to, like, get all of these, like, people right from the jump. Mm-hmm. I also want to say, I don't know if you came across this piece of information, Grant. I want to point out the house in House of a Thousand Corpses is the same house that's in a little movie with Dolly Parton called Best Little Whorehouse in Texas.
No fucking way.
Oh my God.
Have you seen the picture of Rob with Dolly?
I haven't.
There's a picture of them all standing side by side, and knowing that just makes me so much happier.
Okay, let's go with this photo. Really,
but I do want to.
Oh, that rock! Oh, that fucking
this
rocks!
This is perfect.
Hell yes.
It looks like when you import a character from one video game into another one with mods.
Yes!
Robin, this looks like an NPC or like a character skater that you create in Skate 3.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I do wanna get into some of the, like, plot lore, because we're dropping a bunch of names that probably mean nothing. We gotta talk about Fish Boy. So as Grant mentioned, Rainn Wilson, best known as Dwight in The Office, is the premise of the film is it's these two couples end up coming to this roadside attraction haunted house place and end up, like, getting it over their heads with this basically murderous family, and one of the dudes in the couple, or in one of the couples, is Dwight from The Office. And about, like, I want to say maybe like 40 minutes in, not even, his girlfriend wakes up and Bill Moseley is just like, hey, I want to show you this thing that I put together. And Maddie, I want you to search House of a Thousand Corpses Fish Boy in order to get the visual here.
We're making Maddie look up so many videos.
That's fine. Listeners, you just, you know, just join us, I guess. Just, if you have a computer.
Oh, I meant like an image, but this works too. But he essentially converts Dwight's corpse into this just wild, just dead body art. I feel like you could skip ahead.
I just want to say, me and Gavin would kill a Captain Spaulding and Otis Driftwood costume for Halloween.
Here we go. Hang on, about to see Fish Boy. Which again, just look up like, oh, like a fucked up VHS zoom.
This is one of Jim's most epic pranks.
there's Otis and baby.
Yeah,
great
there's
shot.
So much VHS footage, and like there are like post-production zooms. Mm-hmm. It's just, it's very much like a movie that is made by somebody who like is just trying to get literally everything he loves about horror movies into a movie with never having made a movie. But it, like,
Brick House by the Commodores.
Yes.
Oh my god! Oh, cutting his face.
Like, this is so three on a meat hook. I cannot get over just how 70s this all is.
But if you want to skip ahead to the reveal of what the body looks like at the end.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Oh no, Dwight. Behold.
Oh, here we go. Oh god.
I first watched this movie like 2 years ago, and I have not been able to stop thinking about like Fish Boy since. Fish Boy is the greatest thing in this movie.
Oh, this is just wearing a Burn This Flag shirt.
But we also got to talk about Dr. Satan, who is a figure that has been hanging over all of Rob Zombie's oeuvre. Do you want to take the lead on this one, Grant?
Okay, so Dr. Satan is the serial killer who they are searching for in House of a Thousand Corpses. Now, at the end of the film, they find him. He's like a humanoid mechanical beast that does surgery on unwitting patients, like, under the foundation of the Firefly home with Karen Black's husband, who's like a big Frankenstein man. And because this is like a movie that was made for a haunted house, clearly this is like the big reveal. Like, this would be the big room that scares everyone in this haunted house, you know. But everyone got really mad at Dr. Satan and did not like him in the House of a Thousand Corpses. And so in The Devil's Rejects, he's not there. It's all the like style, the like haunted house, all the bright Halloween lights, and a lot of the VHS and Super 8 footage are like missing from The Devil's Rejects, and it's much more streamlined as like a portrait of a fucked up family. And they filmed scenes with Dr. Satan for The Devil's Rejects where he bites out Rosario Dawson's neck.
Oh my god.
They cut it out of the film, and I'm so mad. But Dr. Satan will make an appearance when we talk about a little film called The Haunted World of El Superbeasto.
Oh,
in a very different way.
Oh god.
But yeah.
Well then, I guess we'll just get into these next two songs, because one of these is like 30 seconds long. So.
I believe Spotify is doing something weird with that.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Hang on. Yeah, let's look.
Yeah, it's not.
Oh, okay, it's like actually, yeah,
thing. It's okay.
Okay, never mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Lord of Salem, which is another one of his movies.
That's right,
yes.
Maddie.
Which, of course, I
feel like of the like non-Halloween, non-Firefly ones, this is probably like the one that I have been most like wanting to get around to, just because it's like his weird sort of, from what I can tell, kind of like reflective film. Like it's like him looking at himself in its own weird way.
Kinda, yeah. Yeah. It.
But no.
It had a budget of $1.5 million in its box office. $1.5 million. So
yep. Right out of the money.
Probably lost money, technically.
Yeah, the advertising definitely did that in.
But no, I I've been going back and forth on what song here is the one that stands out to me most, because like they all have, aside from like one that hasn't really landed with me, they all really have like their own unique features. But like, I love the kind of like sludgier stomp of this one, and we probably won't let it play out in full, but
the ending,
like outro of this,
the
is
outro
so
is
fucking
good.
Sick. Where it turns into like this, the it like drowns out into the crowd cheers. Then you hear this like kind of like surf metal like riff and drum beat. It's sick as hell. Like if Rob Zombie made a pivot into rockabilly, like I all for it.
100. Well, Captain Clegg and the Night Terrors is basically what that technically is. I don't know if Rob ever sang with them, but I love them. John 5 is not in Lord of Salem. This entire cast is just horror icons and his brother. Patricia Quinn from Rocky Horror, Dee Wallace from Cujo, Camille Keaton. Oh yeah, and E.T. Camille Keaton from I Spit on Your Grave,
Barbara Crampton
from Reanimator.
Holy shit.
Michael Berryman from The Hills Have Eyes, Clint Howard from Ice Cream Man and Evil Speak. Udo Kier from Blood
yes.
for Dracula.
And Udo Kier the Goat.
Mm-hmm. Jeff Daniel Phillips, who will be playing Herman Munster in his Munster's film.
And he's playing Herman here.
Oh, he is playing a character named Herman. Holy shit. And oh my
Let's
god, Kim Corey is playing a character named Herman Munster.
Herman Munster Jackson.
Come on. God bless you, Rob.
Rob is, he's so cool. Again, like, Rob, he's just like, I fucking love horror movies, and I'm like, I'm just gonna make that my life. And like, he's done it. He's like,
yeah,
he's making horror movies for a living. He's doing like his horror movie music, essentially. Like, the dude's like, this is my bag, and he's like fully chased it to as far as it can go. It like, it rocks. And again, it's led him to the thing he's probably what I imagine has to be like a long time passion project, which is a Munsters remake. Like,
yeah,
I cannot.
Like, dude is living an aspirational life. Like,
I am waiting for the day that where, so I've been getting like advertisements on my Instagram for like preview screenings of movies. I cannot wait for the day where I get an advertisement for, hey, see the Munsters early. Like,
Maddie,
I cannot wait
Maddie,
to get that advertisement.
Maddie, send it my way. Look,
if I see it, Grant, I'm sending it to you, and you better book a flight to LA immediately.
Maddie, we are going to meet up. We're going to watch the Munsters in theaters, and then we're going to hit up a karaoke bar and do a Dracula rendition of biblical proportions.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I'll bring my Rob costume.
You better.
Just trick people into thinking Rob showed up.
You could do it. No, great. You actually could get away with it.
Here's the thing. You're so convincing, and also people will be so like blindly drunk that they will buy it.
Yeah.
People will get pictures about, like, on their phone with me and wake up the next morning and be like, what the fuck is this?
Oh my god. Fuck it. Let's fucking go. Okay. Let's move on to our next song. Yeah. Our next song. Which is one that I recognize pretty quickly. More Human Than Human from White Zombie. So I'm trying to remember why I recognize this one. I feel like I probably saw like some kind of like movie trailer.
Probably one's top 100 greatest rock songs of all time. This one out of all of rock.
I'm gonna pull it out and see where it might have shown up. But yeah, keep going.
So yeah, let me see. More Human Than Human sync.
Oh, there we go.
There's the bones.
There's more moaning.
One time, when I was still working at Target, one of my coworkers put this song on, and a boss walked by right as soon as the moaning started.
Oh my god. Wait, the moaning in the intro to the song is sampled from a post-apocalyptic porn movie called Cafe Flesh.
Holy shit.
Shout out. That sounds awesome.
What's...
This is the only one I have like a story for. I was many years ago in high school. Maybe Grant, you remember this car ride as well. Driving with Grandma to the 4th of July.
That's right.
Fireworks
That's
show.
That's right.
And I was listening to this song in my headphones, and I was like, damn, I hope it's not loud enough to where Grandma hears the moaning. But, I mean, I didn't turn it down, so, I mean, that's... She hasn't said anything in all these years, so I'm guessing not. But, yeah, this song's so sick. This is probably the best one of of the list to me.
You know, I'm reading the description of this on Wikipedia, where they talk about how parts of the video were filmed at a high school in Massachusetts, where I believe Rob Zombie went to high school, and I'm just like, I'm kicking myself that I didn't do like the Rob Zombie tourism tour while I was there, because I missed my window, and it's like, maybe I'll go back and do like a whole like essentially like just like pilgrimage through all the like pivotal Rob Zombie landmarks.
They should do a Rob Zombie tour, but it should be in like a replica of the Munsters car.
Yes.
Like I would be there.
Yeah, the car drives through like a replica of the Firefly house.
I could be the guy that does the tour. I could come out like this. They could be like, and over there's the carnival where Rob Zombie saw a guy get hit in the face with a hammer. That's where he married Sherry. Well, we'd have to go to Vegas for where he married Sherry Moon Zombie by an Elvis impersonator? Question mark.
Shouts out Elvis.
Shouts out to Elvis. In theaters. Second now. Pod in a row we've invoked Elvis.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Still haven't seen it.
You gotta see Gavin, you would love it. I'm not joking.
I'm aware. Look, I know I have to see it, but I think that Grant should be allowed to make the Boz version of Elvis, but about Rob.
Yes.
I would absolutely do that. I'd get Eminem to do a Dracula type beat for the credit.
It'd be called Yeah after this
yes.
song. It'd be called Yeah.
A prestige Rob Zombie movie would be amazing.
Well, it would turn the carnival beating incident and riot into a whole like dramatic beat. It would like the thing is where Rob found his own kind of like inspiration in the kind of like gritty horrors of his own movies would ring it out for all the drama that it's really worth.
Absolutely, yeah. I would 100% kill that movie. I'd be up there dressed like this, getting that Oscar. I'd like
oh
to thank
God.
Sherry Moon Zombie. I'd like to thank Rob.
I just want to really just note quickly. Apparently, he directed an episode of CSI Miami in 2010.
Well, I bet that's awesome.
And a Tom Papa comedy special. For
and Tom Papa is the voice of El Superbeasto.
Oh my God.
Oh my
he
God.
He did not play the lizard in a Spider-Man cartoon.
Looks like he did. Dr. Kirk Connors such the lizard. Holy oh shit. God. Bring him back in fucking again. Nope. Whatever the next Spider-Man movie is. Fuck it.
I'm excited for... I'm glad we're doing this podcast because this weekend a theater by me is showing Slither in 35mm and I'm just going to be keeping an ear out for Dr. Carl this whole time so I can hear Rob's beautiful, beautiful voice.
We just listened to all of that song.
It's good.
It's great. It's good song.
It slaps. Yeah. It is. Yeah, no, I know we've said this before, but like the White Zombie stuff just has like a nice groove to it. Mm-hmm. Like constantly you can jam to it. It's just it feels I understand why like it gave him the start that it did, because like you hear that and you could hear people just like headbanging away to that and like doing kind of their own like bizarre moshes in the pit.
Look, Red Hot Chili Peppers is music for your cousin that shows you a stack of Playboys that he's been hiding from his mom. And White Zombie is music for your cousin that shows you a stack of horror movies he's been hiding from his mom.
Exactly.
Horror movies are like copies of like Fangoria or something.
Oh, 100%.
Mm-hmm. Pictures of dead bodies. Real pictures
real,
that you don't
real
know
real
how a child got.
Real pictures of dead bodies that he found on the quote-unquote deep web.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But in reality, it's just like morbid reality on Reddit.
Yeah.
Or like Faces of Death stills.
Oh, 100%.
Yes. Yeah. Printed out pictures from Faces of Death. Oh,
so I don't have a segue for this movie talk. Let's talk about Rob Zombie's 31. It's a movie where Sherry Moon Zombie and a bunch of people fight a bunch of clowns on Halloween night. It's stupid. It's so incredibly tasteless. I love it. I watch it every Halloween. Tommy Pickles, voice actress, plays one of the clowns named Sexhead.
Incredible. Awesome. I love that. Not only is Malcolm McDowell here, he's playing Father Napoleon, Father Napoleon Horatio Silas Murder.
Ah, good.
Oh my God. Say, Jeff Daniel Phillips, of course. Meg Foster, who's Meg Foster?
Yeah, she was in
okay. Okay. Rob Zombie. I mean, hey, I needed to dive through the discog. Which again, I do love that again in all his movies, mm-hmm. wife is the main star. 100%. All movies,
of course. Well, she wouldn't be. She's not really the star in the Halloweens, but other than that, she's always
yeah.
A star
but
role.
She's in again. But she's in those movies. Role. Yes.
But yeah,
she plays Mrs. Myers. Michael's mom.
We'll get to the Halloweens, and Nat and I will get to the powder keg we've been sitting on. But I think it's time we talk about Rob's new music video.
Yes, please.
Oh hell yeah.
Oh god. So is this shake your ass?
Smoke your grass. Yep. That's right.
Okay, hang on.
Shout out to Cal 50 who has been championing this song for the past 2 days, and who I showed. Both the Living Dead Girl, Rob Zombie official bong, and the Shake Your Ass, Smoke Some Grass grinder. And look, someone should buy that for Cal 50.
Yes, please.
We should, the four of us should chip in, because he was the one who alerted us to the fact that this video came out.
I would be willing to chip in some money.
Oh, same here. Yeah.
Sure, why not?
I love this video
this
so
video
much.
This video is so good.
I hate that I saw a still for this video in the thumbnail, and my first thought was, did Chad Van Galen animate this? Which honestly would be the crossover that would, like, actually kill me.
There's a bunch of monsters just smoking weed. He's already...
Lots of butt shaking, of course, from bimbos.
This is just the loading screens from Tony Hawk's American Wasteland.
Oh my god, but yeah.
Like, it's about smoking weed and with demons. And like, it's awesome. Andy Warhol's here.
Oh, he does not like cigarettes.
Oh.
John 5.
What, again?
There's
you're
Piggy
not gonna, again, fucking Joe Brandon trying to take away my jewel. You better not try to take away two fucking Rob Zombie.
Rob should make a sequel and you call it Let's Be Cool, Smoke Your Jewel. Yeah.
I do gotta love
I'm in support.
We talked about the dreads. Eddie, you paused me here.
Well, I had to.
I mean, we have so much filter.
Okay, so the big cut to a frame of a naked devil woman. Tits out, pussy out, just shaking it. There's Matt, a devil. Matt. There's a devil off center to the left.
Okay, Matt.
His like normal size penis
window
is out.
Is open, and I'm in a building full of elderly people. Please move past this.
And there's also another devil with like a giant cock who has like a mouth.
Do these
coming.
Fuckers ever pop out of the wall and have like a huge cock shot?
Oh my
but,
god.
No, I was gonna say we talked about his. Hair earlier, and I gotta love how like the verses of this are like it starts as his like own weird riff on kind of like reggae music before he just like is like no we're just gonna go right into like hard Rob Zombie shit in the chorus.
Oh, Uncle Sam's eating babies.
OJ Simpson. I had something else I was gonna say. Oh, this song sounds like a good version of the Gary Glitter song.
Oh,
that
oh god.
Has. We should replace that with this at sporting
this,
events.
This should have been playing in Joker.
100%.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's already done like references to The Exorcist and The Wicker Man. God. Oh, Tim Burton's Alice in Wonderland!
But yeah, like the Tim Burton version. Wild.
Oh, he's a skeleton. Oh, I love this part.
God.
Hell yeah, Rob.
Oh, it's a Dracula.
Yeah.
What if you slammed in the back of him?
Yeah.
This video is—it has to be seen to be believed.
Yeah.
Truly, like.
Oh, he's doing scanners.
I don't know what I was expecting from everybody talking about this video, but this really just. This is exactly what I'd expect from...
The woman just popped out some babies.
Grant, I have to imagine this is where Superbeasto comes in, right?
Yeah, it has to be.
Because I don't know how familiar either of you are with just Superbeasto, but it is just... It is such an anomaly in the man's career.
It is the most Ren and Stimpy thing never made officially by Ren and Stimpy.
I just want to note, this is from the album titled The Lunar Injection Kool-Aid Eclipse Conspiracy. What the fuck does that mean, Rob?
That sounds awesome.
What the fuck?
Oh, also, he has the lyrics.
Oh, there's the lyrics.
Can you find a comment in this about the guy that has COVID and pink eye at the same time?
Oh my god, wait, hang on. Let's see. Let me see if I can no, I don't want to add to my bookmarks.
I think you should.
Oh, here we go. I needed this from King Meezy. I needed this, Rob Zombie. Thank you. Street finding out I got COVID and pink eye. It just shows that your music is what's comforting to those that are hurt / sick.
That's so funny.
Buddy, God. I don't think the fluids in this video are going to help you with that pink eye.
Yeah, about to say. No. Oh my god.
How do we move on from that?
How do we move on?
My heart goes out to. Well, we got to talk about a little bit about El Superbeasto.
Oh Christ.
Rosario Dawson plays a character called Velvet Von Black that the second she showed up, I was so uncomfortable. Just everything in that movie is so incredibly horny, and every single horror movie character you could ever think of makes a cameo in it. It's like Ready Player One for people that jerk off to Newgrounds, you know?
Can I read off this cast list? Because this is kind of insane.
It is an insane cast. Oh, so Dr. Satan is back.
Dr. Satan is back. We should talk about his role in here, as you mentioned. It's Tom Papa, Sherry Moon Zombie, Paul Giamatti, which I believe is the only thing he's been in with Rob Zombie.
Yes.
Rosaria Dawson, Tom Kenny, Brian Posehn, D. Wallace, Robert Paulson, Danny Trejo, Clint Howard, Deborah Wilson, John DiMaggio.
Isn't Elvira in this? Cassandra Peterson?
Maybe. Yes. Elvira.
There we go. Wow. Again,
so Dr. Satan.
Wait, Tom Kenny? SpongeBob?
Yes.
SpongeBob.
What the fuck? Is that allowed? I don't know if that's allowed.
I mean, Tommy Pickles was in 31, so I guess.
That's
true. He's getting all the Nickelodeon classics, you know?
This is true. Well then.
But wait, Grant, did you want to talk about Dr. Satan in this one?
Movie, Dr. Satan is not a mad scientist humanoid man that does surgery on unwitting patients. He's a very horny little red devil man that wants to have sex with Rosario Dawson's character to birth the Antichrist or something. I don't remember much about it.
Huh.
He's a little goofy man that bears no resemblance to himself in House of a Thousand Corpses, and I kind of respect that. Rob's a visionary that isn't afraid to change his characters up.
However, I am seeing that both Sid Haig and Mosley are back in this one.
Yes, as their House of a Thousand Corpses characters.
Well then, let's move on to our next song. Our next song is, again, speaking of Rob Zombie movies, it's The Devil's Rejects from Rob Zombie. Which I guess is the title track for the film.
Speaking of his goes country.
Yep.
Yeah, which The Devil's Rejects is widely regarded as his best movie, usually by most critics.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the one that most people go to bat for. Mm-hmm. Like anytime someone wants to trash Rob Zombie's movies, they're always like, I love The Devil's Rejects, but you know. Mm-hmm. I don't remember this one at all.
It's gonna wait for it to come in a little bit.
Yeah, it's got that the intro.
Which again, I did not get snippets for this one. I just, no offense, listeners. I just didn't feel like it. we're just gonna listen. And also, I just fingers crossed that my internet connection is decent. Again, just play these songs with very little glitching or buffering, so it sounds smooth.
I love that this one just sounds like the slide guitar, and it just sounds like you're just hearing ghostly wails.
Yeah,
The dude for all the stuff about him, the people who are critics about him being one note, knows how to nail the different sounds in his repertoire.
I definitely think so. I think he's pretty good at doing country. This one's got a little bit of that spooky theremin type of stuff I like, even though it's not really a theremin, it's a slide guitar. But I will say, of all the songs on this list, this is probably the one that I would probably call the weakest. I don't know. I like them all, but it's just very slow. It works best in context if you're familiar with the movie.
Yeah, it always seems like something that like is better. Like if I watched the movie, it would hit just that much more.
Yeah. Especially with how the movie ends, from what I've heard, like having this come in like right after that is definitely kind of like, yeah.
This comes in right after Freebird.
Yes.
I'm gonna say yeah. Is it time to talk about the Devil's Rejects, or are we gonna hold off on
Let's talk about the Devil's Rejects. Have you seen the Devil's Rejects, Maddie?
I have not. I've only seen the kill count for the Devil's
Rejects. It's on HBO Max. You should check it out.
Alrighty.
There's Danny Trejo is in it. Ken Foray is in it, but he's in everything Rob Zombie does. It's pretty good. What's her name? PJ Souls from Halloween has a brief cameo in it. It's definitely a lot more streamlined and straightforward than House of a Thousand Corpses. So obviously it's not going to be my favorite because I like the wackadoo energy of House of a Thousand Corpses. But I think a lot of people have complaints with Rob Zombie's dialogue, but I think this is the one that has like the most, not to say basic, but basic dialogue. Usually all his stuff are like sayings you would hear in his songs, which people complain about, but I think why would you watch a Rob Zombie movie if you don't want Rob Zombie energy? But this one, it has a little bit of it. There's an infamous scene where Sid Haig and Sherry Moon are just screaming the words "tutti fucking fruity" over and over again. But other than that, it's pretty straightforward, you know. But I like it. It's gritty, it's violent, and it's uncomfortable all the time. There's a famous scene, the scene where Ken Foray is at a chicken truck, and he's talking about how he sells them, and he wants to question people if they're gonna fuck the chickens. It's all from the mind of Rob Zombie, you know. Gavin, didn't you have like a teacher in high school that kept talking about how The Devil's Rejects was his favorite movie? Like a social studies teacher?
I don't know how you remember this, because I
forgot his name, but he was in the portable next to mine, and everyone kept asking him like for his political views, and he kept saying, "I'm a teacher, you shouldn't do that," and he kept talking about how his favorite movie is The Devil. I think he had a Devil's Rejects poster in his...
That might be familiar, but I don't remember him, but I believe it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure there was a teacher at our school who had a Devil's Reject poster up.
Yeah.
Well, it's time for everybody to fuck in a UFO. Everybody's fucking in a UFO from Rob Zombie.
We gotta pull up the video for this one, I'm sorry.
Okay, hang on, yeah, let me pull up the video before, yeah. Oh, God. okay,
this is
going to
be the most visual episode of this podcast ever. I say that now, but
don't speak too soon.
This one's not like as there's not as much going on. Shake your ass, smoke your grass. It's just you just need the vibes of this in order to fully like get what he's going for. Like, look at him. God. Look at
the second one. It looks like the Big Bopper.
Yes.
A Rob Zombie film.
Oh yeah, there's like a whole short. We could skip this.
Proposed by Albert Einstein in 19. Is that Sherry?
Oh, Sherry!
There we go.
Hell yeah!
Oh,
we got those freaky aliens, freaky spaces, freaky alien dicks.
Yeah.
Oh, I have not seen the dicks yet. Oh, no.
The cardboard robot in the back.
Yeah, this is the one that's literally just Jesus built my hot rod.
Yes.
Evan.
I was going to say Jerry was a race car driver.
Holy shit, yeah.
Again, with the Primus connection. Yeah. God, this song fucks so hard.
This one's a little too Primacy for me, I think.
See, this is...
But I mean, I have to support it because it's a song called "Well, Everyone's Fucking in a UFO."
The word UFO is for real, okay. Just put up on the screen.
But I feel like this circumvents like my normal...
Alien dick! Maddie, you're not even looking at what's happening right now.
Sorry.
Those aliens got their dicks out for you.
Oh, what the fuck?
This is so much worse than the porno episode.
Yeah, This is probably gonna be worse.
I was getting it though.
I feel like this circumvents like the typical shit I have with Primus, where you got like, I feel like the breakdowns here are just sick. This is my breakdowns for Christ. Is Rob Zombie going breakdowns for alien dick? Breakdowns for alien dick.
Oh my. He's wearing a goose suit.
Yep.
He's goosed up.
Yep.
It's an old circus term, okay? Jizz on the walls.
Hell yeah.
Looks like someone left a huge cum shot over here, man. You know?
Oh, the robot monster from the movie Robot Monster. Rob, I get your references. I love you.
He's got the Becky Lynch glasses on right now. When she was a steampunk.
Oh, Cherry.
Do you think Rob would
Do we already come in that he's wearing an unidentified fucking object?
No, we have not.
No.
Here's the thing. Do you think Rob and Sherry would open their very monogamous relationship for one of these aliens?
Probably, yeah.
Probably.
It's an alien. I mean, it's like, you gotta say...
Yeah.
Just
the
to say
you did
it.
The only way you're getting in there is if you're an alien or if you're fucking, like, Frankenstein. That's the only way you're invading there.
Or if you're a monster.
Beautiful love. Yeah.
But anyway, we talked about Rob having big dumb guy energy, and I feel like he knows that, he owns up to it, because like, when you make a song called "Well, Everybody's Fucking in a UFO," you gotta just deliver on that premise. You just gotta go for it. You go for broke and just get to it the most direct way possible. This really is a porn songs episode.
Yeah. What the fuck?
Oh god.
That's the thing. Is
Zombie. I have two thoughts. What the serious fuck? This is the best thing ever. I agree, Wolfgang 735.
That's
I agree.
Right.
That's the thing, is we Trojan horse this into being like, look at Rob Zombie, he's a wacky guy, and then we ended up doing two porn episodes in a single week.
Basically.
Oh god. Oh, Jesus Christ. Our next song, I guess. Our next song. Listen, any final thoughts on, well, everybody's fucking in a UFO.
What is there to say?
What is there to say?
From White Zombie right now, it's "I'm Your Boogeyman." I like this one. Yeah, this one's really good.
This one's probably the one that hasn't landed for me, but I think it was because I was getting zombie fatigue by this point in the playlist, and it was also coming right after "Well, Everybody's Fucking in a UFO."
I love this sample. Sampling the original Halloween, "The Boogeyman's Gonna Get You," and your "I'm Your Boogeyman" cover. First off, did we mention this is a cover of the Casey and the Sunshine Band song?
Is it?
Yeah. Yes.
What the fuck?
Don't hold your horses on disco covers.
That's true.
That. I think it might actually be Casey and the Sunshine Band too.
It's possible. I like this. I really like this. I really like the original Casey and the Sunshine Band song. That one is just tasty instrument riff after tasty instrument riff for every single instrument in that song. This one just turns into a White Zombie song, and since it was already funky, they did a good job with it. This is basically here so we could talk about Rob Zombie's Halloween.
Oh boy, let's... man, I'm Boogeyman. Do we just gonna get right into Michael, or...?
First off, I want to talk about that's for Rob Zombie's Halloween 2, my friend. Let's talk about Rob Zombie's Halloween 1.
Of course.
People who say this remake is the worst thing in the Halloween franchise are stupid, they're wrong, and they're dumb.
Oh yeah, no, definitely wrong. You have fucking 4 through 6, especially like 5 and 6, like, come the fuck on.
Where Halloween Kills exists, let's not crucify Rob Zombie for trying something different. I've always heard that this is terrible, that this is bad. I watched it, I liked it. I actually, a lot of people get mad that like the first half of it is a prequel with Michael Myers' life and what he was like before he became Michael Myers as we know him. I don't think you could recreate the reveal of Michael being a 6-year-old when he kills his sister. I was watching the original Halloween last year, the day before Halloween, and I left the room because I was getting candy ready, mixing it in the bowl. And when I came back, my mom was sitting there and it was still the title cards. And she sat there as she watched the entire point of view shot of Michael going up, killing Judith and coming back down. And when the dad pulls off the mask and it's revealed that Michael is 6 years old, my mom literally just went, "Oh my God," because she knew nothing about the movie. And it was adorable. But you can't, people who are going to go see a remake of Halloween already know this shit, you know? So I think he did the right thing, trying something different. If you want to see the same Halloween that you, just go watch the fucking John Carpenter version if you want to see the John Carpenter version. I do agree that Linda Vanderkot, one of the best characters in the original, kind of gets the shaft. She's introduced, and then her death scene is immediately after. But other than that, I like the Michael stuff. I like his take on the actual Halloween Night Massacre. I like Malcolm McDowell as Sam Loomis. Nat, do you have any thoughts before we drop the bomb about where young Michael Myers is now?
I don't, primarily because this is like my one of my biggest blind spots is not having watched either of his Halloweens, despite like everybody I know like fawning over them a lot. But yeah, no, I have to say that like even as somebody who hasn't watched them and like knows especially in detail about like how much people have like really come around to Halloween 2 in recent years, I feel like there's something to be said about the fact that like just hearing about how zombie approaches the material, I feel like this is kind of, this gets to the core of kind of the misconstrued nature of Rob Zombie, I feel like, where it feels like, as far as I know, like a lot of his stuff with the Halloween movies really kind of gets to his core of like using his movies for genuine sincerity and empathy when he can. It's not just all goofy wacky shit House of a Thousand Corpses. And even still, when it is goofy wacky shit, it comes from a place of like deep earnestness in his heart. And so like I feel like I whenever I get around to them, I absolutely cannot fault them for that, and I will probably end up kind of having similar reactions to a lot of people, because I would like that is a much more to me, that makes a lot more sense than coming at it from like a kind of like remove, like say like the ones from the last couple of years have been doing.
We can't talk about Halloween Kills. I will get mad.
I will also.
I went to the movies with my boyfriend a couple of days ago, and we were talking about what was the last movie we saw. In theaters, and it was Halloween Kills, and I just immediately started ranting about how much I hate that movie. We can't get into it, but I do agree with you about the point that these movies are oddly filled with empathy for the slasher victims in a way that I don't really see in a lot of other slasher films. Especially, I'll talk about in Halloween 2, the character of Annie, who is played by Daniel Harris, who is Jamie Lloyd in Halloween 5 and 4. Yes. She survives Rob Zombie's Halloween. She's a character that died in the original, but she follows over into the next film and she dies in it, and it's genuinely like a sad, upsetting death, which at this point, if you've seen a million slashers like me, you don't really get those. The characters exist to be special effects reels, but this is genuinely upsetting to watch. I really grew to appreciate these films. The old head horror fans that that have been trashing these for two decades, get over it. Go soy face at Halloween Kills when a character you recognize shows up or whatever. Like, look, it's Sheriff Brackett, and he's saying the thing he said in a passing conversation to Lori 50 years ago. Go fuck
you,
yourself.
You deep fake Donald Pleasance.
Oh, yeah.
Well, actually, I don't think it's totally deepfaked. I think like
an impersonator.
Yeah, it's like the producer.
Like not even intentional. It's just like some, because I did recently watch the Halloween Kills kill count from Dead Meat, and it was like there was just a guy on the crew who like looked pretty much exactly like Donald Pleasance, and we're just like, all right, dude, like hey, like you want to play? Hey, we need to do this flashback. Do you want to play him? And they just like put some like minor prosthetics on him, and I think they used a. I want to say they use like some old ADR.
Yeah, they use someone who sounds like him, and he just
sounds like him, or like some ADR from like a previous movie. Which, you know, hey, that's if you're gonna do that, it's probably the best way to do it. Where it's like, unlike the fucking right now, the Star Wars series with the fucking
the CGI
Luke Skywalker or whatever, like
Carrie Fisher.
Like, just find a guy that looks like him. Just find again. There's something so simple. Just find a guy that looks like the person. You know, like. The deep fake technology is like not like, I get it, you kind of have to just break through and keep working at the stuff to make it better, but it's like maybe we shouldn't even be doing that. Like maybe that's probably not worth it. Like maybe we should just, I don't know, just find people that look like these people, you know?
Yeah, like say what you will about that fucking Shining sequel, I had no problems with the Shelley Duvall and the Scatman Crothers. The kid from Gremlins being Jack Nicholson was weird, but he was shot in portrait. It's whatever. Halloween Kills sucks. David Gordon Green, I'm going to come to your house and hate Maddie, please censor that.
I will. But Danny McBride. Danny McBride is cool.
Yeah, Danny McBride on thin fucking ice for Righteous Gemstones.
You know, it'd be a shame if they ended up at a carnival where a riot was happening.
Yes, yeah.
Ooh.
Gavin just left the room, but Gavin has to
he
be
said,
here.
He just said, Ruby Zuby, Rob Knob, I have to pee. Don't try to listen. LOL.
Well, now me and Nat have been sitting on this powdered keg that we've been wanting to reveal for like weeks now. And now Gavin left the room.
Yeah, it was
we'll wait for Gavin.
So for context, until Gavin gets back, because we gotta draw this out, I was just minding my business one day and Grant just DMs me this YouTube link with, like, I believe there was like no context attached. Let me try to find the original messages. And you like just sent it to me with the sort of then afterward the added context.
Yes, I did. I needed to send it immediately. I couldn't find the words. I literally just found that, and I was like, "Oh my god! Nat needs to see this."
Yeah. Hang on, slightly off topic. While we're still waiting for Gavin, Grant, what are your thoughts on the Toxic Avenger, Grant, as a horror movie buff of some sorts?
The trauma film.
Yes.
If I had to do a ranking of the series right now, 1, 4, 3, 2, I enjoy it. Great head crushing.
Are you excited about the remake that's coming out?
Yes,
soon?
I am.
Which the remake, which again, I'm not sure how much I can reveal because I basically had to sign NDA. I saw it. It's good. I think that's all I can legally say. Probably.
Does Lloyd Kaufman have a cameo like they do with Stan Lee and all those fucking movies?
I think he does have a cameo in it. I can't remember. Hell yeah. I can't remember off top, but he probably has a cameo somewhere.
That's
okay.
Right.
Gavin is back.
Right.
What is this grand reveal you two
okay,
have?
Okay, hold on. I got to bring up the link. All right. So, as I discussed with Rob Zombie's Halloween, quite a bit of it is in the past with a young Michael Myers. In the original film, young Michael Myers just shows up in the prologue. Nothing else really. Here he's a full character of his own.
Yes.
He's played by someone with the most Tim Robinson name I've ever seen, which is Daeg Faerch, which is spelled DAEGFAERCH. And this is what he's doing now. I'm sending it to you.
From Daeg Faerch, you defeds. Official music video, Great Day, prod by Shaggy the Airhead. Oh man. Oh my god. Oh, this is, oh god. This hurts my eyes already.
You have no idea how much it's hurt me to not even, like, let on about this.
I'm out to get bread, I'm out to get mine. Is this a joke? He has more songs.
This is, I mean, it's pretty much, it's just, he kind of looks like at this point, like a SoundCloud Rob Zombie.
Yeah.
SoundCloud Rap Rob Zombie.
It's essentially what he is.
He just sounds so white, you know, like, he just sounds... Who's like the one rapper that like raps in just like the most white voice ever, where it sounds like he's rapping in like Times New Roman? It's this.
This guy is similar. That like white guy southern accent too. It's just incredible.
Oh my god. Holy shit. Oh, what the fuck?
So when Grant sent me a different video from Dang, and I opened it in the vicinity of, because I was I was with my girlfriend at the time, and I was like, Grant sent me this, I have no idea what this is, but I have to watch it immediately. And we were just sitting there in dumbfounded silence, watching this guy rap and, like, just, like, gesture for the camera and with this dumb voice. And it's mesmerizing. Something about it is just, I can't stop looking. It's like a true train wreck spectation.
There's video of him in 2014 rapping at some horror convention, and it's the saddest thing I've ever seen.
We cannot watch that. That's just too sad.
Yeah.
But, speaking of sad, our next song is Michael from Rob Zombie. Michael, of course, being Michael Myers from the album Hellbilly Deluxe 2. I did not realize until like very recently, like how much of a like cult following that Halloween 2 has. Like, I was looking at my phone earlier during the during the Aliens video, because I was looking at the Letterboxd reviews for Halloween 2 and seeing like, oh wow, like there's people who like really put some like serious thought into like their love for this movie. But
yeah, it's pretty fairly getting cultural reappraisal. At the time, everyone was mad because it wasn't the Halloween they were used to. But Rose, we gotta talk about Rose. Rose has said so much that Halloween 2 is like a 10 out of 10 to her. And when I first heard that, I was like, there's no way this movie is a 10 out of 10. But it is probably one of my favorite Halloweens ever.
Wow.
To me, it's the original Halloween 3 Season of the Witch and Rob Zombie's Halloween 2. Those are my favorites.
Yeah, Season of the Witch is great. Yes. Season of the Witch rocks.
I gotta do Season of the Witch 2. That's, yeah.
I think it's on HBO Max, I want to say.
I think so,
I have the disc of it, but yeah. It's, yeah, no. Like, the way that I've seen people talk about it is part of the reason why I wanted to, like, delve into Rob Zombie more seriously. I feel like that was the real, like, inciting thing that got me to like consider Rob Zombie in a sense of more of just like, oh, you mean the wacky guy who does like horror movies and songs. Like the way that people have talked about, especially kind of like how it deals with like actually grappling with like traumatic responses in a way that's not just like the kind of like horror buzzwordy way, and 100%. Also like dealing with like fallout from like assaults and just childhood PTSD. It sounds like the way that people talk about it and kind of see themselves like really intensely in it is the kind of thing that really is only, and so regularly from like a lot of people that I know, is really the only thing that's there from like somebody who like truly understands it rather than somebody who's trying to evoke it in order to like fit into like a typical crowd.
Yeah, I'll say it. Scout Taylor Compton doing a traumatized Laurie Strode in Halloween 2. Better than Jamie Lee Curtis is doing right now.
Wow.
I it cannot be any worse than hers.
Yeah. Don't you love it when you're so scared of a serial killer that came after you 40 years ago that you home alone your own house? But David Gordon Green, I will find your home address. I genuinely fell in love with this movie. The biggest complaint I have with it is that Brad Dourif just talks in his Chucky voice, and that's just a minuscule thing, you know? Like, Michael is interesting in this. Laurie is definitely interesting in this. And it ends on such a great note that, like, I mean, this is genuinely, like, this takes the Halloween franchise and says, we're doing something new with these characters in a way that genuinely has never been done before. We'll probably get a million takes on Michael Myers and Laurie Strode in the coming years, and they're all gonna be the William Shatner mask and the innocent babysitter, but except this one fantastic anomaly that genuinely I is gonna become a part of my rotation every year for Halloween. Rob Zombie hit 2 for 2 with his Halloween franchise, which is more than the established franchise has. It's like, I don't know. I just really gravitated to these films.
I want to talk about the song itself. Cause yes. I feel like this kind of, just in terms of looking at it compared to like his cover of I'm Your Boogeyman, I feel like this really gets like we were talking about the movie songs kind of nailing the sort of emotional kind of like or the tone of how they end off, and like this one like I think really works for me. It definitely it feels like just like really great at like being like somber and really kind of like embodying the being in the shoes of its character and like the verses, and then when it explodes into that chorus, it just the dynamics there like really make it hit.
Yeah, this is a movie that feels immense sympathy for all of its characters, and it bleeds through into this song. You know, I really thought that Rob Zombie's Halloween 2 was going to be a bad movie just because of the buzz around it, but I don't know, the same people that like shit their pants over Hereditary and stuff are calling this bad, and I'm saying you're wrong and you're bad, and the best way to watch Hereditary is imagining Toni Collette is like a mink stole screaming at her stupid kid.
Yeah, ever since you showed me The Great Gag, I've just been scrolling his Twitter. Hell yeah. Instagram, so I'm sorry. I don't know what the fuck. I have nothing to say about this song. It's over for me.
Find anything interesting, Gavin?
Nothing too good right now. He posts a lot of photos of himself as a child with Rob Zombie.
That's right. Chase that bag, dig. Have you found his...
I'm
have you found his song Lemon Pepper?
I have not. I'm looking exclusively at his... Oh, he tweeted Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang, Gucci Gang in 2017. Hell yeah.
Yeah. Oh my God. Good for you, Dig. But I think it's time. Yeah. I think it's time we approach...
our final song of the evening. Ging Gang Gong Day Dude Gong Day Laga Rock. This sounds racist. This sounds racist. But let's hear Ging Gang Gong Day Do Gong...
De Laga Raga.
Thank you. Oh my God.
You just feel bad saying that. It like feels bad in your mouth.
Yes.
Again, with his like just going full on Jesus Built My Hot Rod vocal effects.
Yeah, they should call this Jesus Built My Dragula.
Well, you say that, but like in my head, when I saw this song title, I'm like, is that basically what Gibby Haynes is doing in that song? He's just doing those like vocalizations where it's like, ding, dang, ding, da, dang, da, dang.
Yeah, Jesus Built My Hot Rod is the best Rob Zombie song Rob Zombie never wrote.
Hold on, I'm going to pull up the lyrics to this, because this is definitely like where he gets the most Kiedis-y, I feel like.
Yeah, this is major Kiedis energy.
Yeah, I think I have Rob fatigued by this point in the playlist.
A little bit, yeah. It's always the issue that's going to come up when you do these singles. Although, again, this is obviously better than some of the single artist posts we've done. Because I think just Rob is just such a weird guy.
Take that, Lady Gaga.
Well, again, I think Lady Gaga and Rob Zombie do have like very similar energies of just like they have their bit, their niche, and they stick to it, but they have wild variations on it, you know, like. None of these songs, again, these are all clearly like Rob Zombie creations, but it's still a very diverse set of songs,
at
times.
I would kill to see a Rob Zombie, A Star Is Born, where like Sherry is the Lady Gaga character.
Yes.
God.
And he'll find, God bless him, man will find another inventive way to show her ass.
Absolutely, yes.
So I would like to read the first verse into like the sample that happens on this song. They call me Shindig Johnny Punk, a regular ghost face peep show funk. They call me Screaming Lord Dinosaur, Commander-in-Chief of a Voodoo War. They call me Mother Superior Joe, broadcasting Casanova Radio. They call me King Kong Raisin Brand, a fortified Hollywood devil man. Yeah, strapped behind the wheel of a flatbed truck, a payload of pussy and Peking duck. High on the fumes and high on the gas, rally round the girl with the skull on her ass. This is just an Anthony Kiedis like lyric sheet.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I don't like hearing Rob say the word pussy. I feel like he should be a little more spooky about it.
They call me Pentagram Peter Pan. That is, come on.
Yeah, that's Kiedis.
God, it's... I love that we're ending a song with a song that is basically complete nonsense, because it's proving my point that, like, Rob Zombie knows. I'm so sorry, but Gavin.
Yeah, Gavin has found a video from Dake Fairch with the hashtag I fucking love blunts. It's a video of him smoking a blunt.
Just smoking.
Let me see if it loads. Twitter can be really weird sometimes whenever I try to like.
Yeah, it's been doing that for me too. But this song just proves the point for me that like Rob Zombie knows that he could be stupid and then just plays into it, because it's like he doesn't think this is like deep lyrically. He's just going for something that's just pure vibes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, I'll cross the street and go visit my work. What up, bitches?
This video looks like it was shot on like a burner phone that was sent to somebody in prison.
Yeah.
Like, it looks like a smuggled prison phone.
Yeah.
AKA just like whatever new Android device just came out, pretty much.
What's the other thing that Gavin sent? Gavin said another thing.
Oh yeah, there's a tattoo
of
the child Michael Myers. With the caption, happy hashtag Michael Myers Monday, the perfect reminder that I'm still the only horror icon in the rap game. Hashtag scary boy, hashtag tattoo, hashtag worldwide, hashtag ink, hashtag boogie, hashtag rapper, hashtag producer, hashtag FYP, hashtag explore, hashtag insta good.
Well, not anymore. Now that Method Man released a song for Evil Dead the Game that starts with the line, shout out to Sam Raimi, and alludes to the JFK shooting and the Waco siege in the first verse, you're not the only,
that's awesome.
Only rapper in the horror game, Dake.
Oh my god.
I want to say, I also... watched a 2007 or 2011 recreation of the entirety of Rob Zombie's Halloween in The Sims 2 while I was at work last week.
Incredible.
Yeah,
there is a...
Whoa.
There's a great Dake fan page. Okay, here we go. Here's the... fucking Instagram.
I'm allowed to say this, but like one of those pics, like the long hair and the like septum piercing, like he would make such a good trans girl.
He was in
Okay, yeah, he would make such a good trans girl.
Oh my god.
That must be the name of a song. Everything else is a piece of media guy. He was in.
Oh, yeah, like,
well, maybe he was.
He's like fucking, it's like it's young Jason, you know, the kid who played Jason Voorhees in Friday the 14th, who just like,
yeah, who has the band convention. First Jason.
Exactly. Like,
incredible.
It's just a modern version of that kid.
So I feel like if we've exhausted our Dag stuff, there is one important piece of Rob filmography that I believe we've glossed over. I Grant, I wonder if you know what I'm mentioning here.
I don't, actually.
Have you seen the fake trailer
for Grindhouse? Yes, the Nazi werewolf
woman of the SS.
Yeah.
I can get you, there's a bunch of ones here.
We're going to get Maddie on a list.
Here, Maddie, I'll just send you the link. Because okay, it's like you. There's a bunch of like fake burner ones, but
okay, I see.
Yeah, let me send it in chat.
Oh boy! Oh yeah.
But God, it's speaking of like weird kind of racist shit.
Oh no! Here we go.
Yeah, so the backstory for Grindhouse, they got a bunch of horror directors to make fake trailers, and this is Rob Zombie's contribution.
Tribute to, like, the video nasties, Ilsa, She-Wolf of the SS, and Love Camp 9. Nazi exploitation was a thing in the 70s.
Oh, yes. Home of the Nazis' diabolical
plans to create an army of super... This almost looks too good to be fully Grindhouse.
Yeah.
That's kind of the whole thing with it, is it's definitely like these were made in 2007.
Yeah.
Hi, Udo here.
I like to imagine that that Quentin Tarantino saw this and was like, all right, I know what my next movie is going to be. It's going to be a movie about the Nazis. Thanks, Rob.
There she is.
Oh, there's Sherry. Can they alone supply the blood? Even in a fucking like fake trailer for Grindhouse, it's got to be in there.
Gotta be in there, gotta focus on her ass.
There you go. It's a great ass.
I'm allowed to lust over Sherry Moon Zombie. It's my right as a lesbian.
Yeah. Yeah. Sybil Danning. Yeah. Bill Mosley. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh no.
And Nicolas Cage. Oh no. As
Fu Manchu. Oh no.
No.
Oh no.
Oh, his beard is Rob. Worse than mine.
Which I think is, I mean, it's just...
it is like literally falling off, which is part of the touch. Written and directed
by Rob Zombie. I want to please make this a real movie. I want to see it. Yeah. I want to see this damn
movie.
It's weird
that this is one of the ones they didn't make. They made fucking Machete and Hobo with a Shotgun.
Mm-hmm. Oh my god. Well then, That's Rob Zombie, everybody. This was wonderful. This was a wonderful journey into the mind of one Mr. Rob Zombie. I definitely need to watch some more of his movies, especially again. I guess I gotta check out, you know, his Halloween remake.
Indieheads watch night.
I'm down.
Again, we definitely should be having more movie nights in the Discord server. That's definitely something I'm not opposed to doing. Although obviously. The reason why I can't is I'm a very busy man sometimes, you know? Look, I'm a very busy
look,
man.
Look, Grant, if you and I want to, like, curate this shit, I'm down for it. Yes. I'm down to host.
Again, yes. I'm happy. Although we did have an accidental watch night, the fucking Pinocchio movie starring Pauly Shore, because Barely Harsh was streaming that in our Discord.
We also watched Paw Patrol,
also the Paw
movie.
Patrol movie. How could you forget?
Yeah. Oh, that's true. Of course. For the Paw Patrol interlude that we just talked over the entire time during that episode, which I think was a bonus. So, oh my god. Well then, that's it, everybody. Grant, thank you so much for putting together this playlist.
Thank you for enduring it.
And welcome once again to the Indieheads podcast as an official cast member.
It feels fantastic. I actually have a couple things to plug.
Okay, go for it.
First off, I want to plug Evil Dead the game. Someone play this with me. It's a multiplayer game and I have no friends.
Yeah, wait,
and
Xbox
I'd also
or...
like to it's
what,
cross-platform.
What console?
Ooh,
I have PlayStation, but yeah.
Let me get on that.
And
yeah, for sure.
I'd also like to plug the music video for Shake Your Ass, Smoke Your Grass by Rob Zombie.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm happy to have Grant on so we can finally do Collusion together. It's going to be awesome. You're not even ready for it. You're going to regret it within a month.
Well then, that is the episode. Let's see, what do we have up next? Cuz we had to shuffle around our order a little bit cuz we had to take last week off.
You know what's next?
Well, okay, obviously I know what's next. We had to take last week off cuz Jackie had to do her Ethel Kane profile, which I've not checked it out. Hey, Paper Magazine, go check out her fucking cover story that she did for Ethel Kane.
Broke the Paper Magazine Twitter.
Again, got them suspended temporarily. But coming up next, for our bonus patrons, or for our Row One's patrons, Adult Entertainment Contemporary, the episode you've probably heard about already for about the past month. You've heard Brian Pumper. Now I get to experience this myself. But after that, we have a Q2 roundup that's coming out. Just Q2 again. We're going back to our roots as a podcast. Talked about new indie music, so we're talking about that. And then we're all going to be at fucking Pitchfork Music Festival in about 2 weeks.
Two weeks.
Which is fucking nuts. It's that soon. Like Jesus Christ. So we're going to be there. So if you're going to Pitchfork and you see us, hey, come say hi. We're going to be recording some stuff at the festival. We'll have a sort of a mainline episode as usual. We'll also have a little bonus episode at the fest. So I'll be doing stuff. I might be doing some Reddit talk, indie head stuff, talking to artists, more details about that as I'm still trying to book and confirm shit. But hey, I'm going to be there. Natalie's going to be there. AJ, Max, and Jackie will be there. And a bunch of people, a couple of our guests are going to be there. Very excited to meet some people and see some people that I haven't seen in a very long time. So I'm very, very excited to go to Chicago. It's been too long. There we go. And that is it. Hopefully you all enjoyed this episode. We will see you all, for the real ones. We'll see you all very, very pretty much. We'll see you all tomorrow, I think, for the Porno for Patrons finale, and then for Best New Pod Listeners, we'll have a new episode out on Wednesday. So yep, we'll see y'all later. Bye bye.